Hi, everybody. Let me get all my cameras. Oh, I forgot. I have to leave one on you. I'm so glad to have you guys join us today. Is this anyone's first cooking social? My name is Karen, and I will be cooking with you. I am not a professional chef, just a home cook. And Katie is joining us as stage manager and on camera so that you don't just look at me cook the whole time. Oh, Robin, welcome for your first cooking social. It's so much fun. These are so, they always end up being so good. And I'm really excited about this month's because it is a sheet pan dinner. Yeah, Steph, I mean, I don't know about you, but my oven even has a delay. And if I do a vegetarian one, I can have it cook while I'm at work and then it's just ready for me when I get home. So I'm definitely all about that. So we're gonna go ahead and get started. Usually I do a vegetarian version. Today, I'm actually not. I am using sausage. I do like the Beyond sausages, but they don't really hold up very well when you slice it. And I just didn't think it would be as good as tofu. I consider myself a flexitarian. So I am actually, for my very first social, going to be using actual meat today. So I'm not deviating at all. I think my favorite one that I made, it was not this July, but the July before, it was a puff pastry tomato. And it was so easy to put together and it was absolutely delicious.
Well, okay, and that was like a pizza, right?
It was puff pastry. It was puff pastry and it had cheese and tomatoes and basil. And I think that was basically it. It was so good. Oh, well, Natasha, Jan, you can definitely make this recipe your own, just like the journal. I already have my oven preheating and I'm actually going to use the convection roast. And well, fingers crossed, people said in the club that it cooks a little faster than they were expecting. So we'll kind of see how it goes. But I'm going to go ahead and get started. This is a pretty simple, easy one. I'm going to go ahead and get my produce all cut up and I'm going to get my chicken cut up and I'm literally throwing it into a big bowl that I'm going to add the dressing and toss with. And I already have, I know it's not as environmentally friendly to throw aluminum foil on the baking pan, but that's what I'm going to do because my husband does the dishes and he's a really good man and I don't want to make more dishes for him than I have to for tonight. So one discrepancy I did notice is that this is actually a sweet potato and the flesh is light colored. And in the photo, it is actually a yam. I think either would be delicious or a mixture of both. And I think kale would be a nice addition to this or some roasted garlic. You can always use this as a base and throw other things in. Well, Dawn, let me know how those field roast plant-based sausages taste. Sometimes, even in my purple carrot vegan meals, I don't like the way they end up tasting. So I went ahead and went with chicken. Like I said, it's my first time to have meat in a social. So I'm just going to cut these guys up. These were smaller, so I'm going to be using three.
I agree with Angela. I'm not a sweet potato fan either. We were just talking about, if you say potato, I think savory. So sweet kind of messes with my mind. So I stay away from
it. I love a sweet potato and black bean chili. It's one of my favorite go-to recipes in the winter. I love it. I think it really does complement each other very well. I'm a big fan of sweet potatoes as a fast and easy dinner or using it like cook off some quinoa or something along those lines, and then your roasted vegetables, and then throw some sort of like dressing from Trader Joe's over the top, and you got a meal with like 5 minutes of actual energy. When I was looking for my sweet potatoes, I will mention that I did try to look for ones that were all about the same size, or at least that I could cube about the same size. Oh no, what's up? What's up with my sweet stuff? I missed it.
She tripped and her ankle now looks
the size. Oh no. Yeah. Oh Steph, good luck. That's never fun to go to the ER ever. Okay. So I'm still chopping here. And if I threw my back out doing, I'm trying to finish up my teaching hours. Well, I finished up my teaching hours, my individual hours on apparatus. And so in the last 2 days, I did 6 hours of Pilates. and I have pulled my lower back. So if I'm moving a little slower, if you see me move a little jerkily, that would be why. Yeah, it's super fun. The certification is going to kill me. And I'm actually going to throw the little baby ends into the compost. And Snickers doesn't seem to be interested in the sweet potatoes, but I have a feeling when the Brussels sprouts come out, hopefully you have them wanting to get
it. Nice. Ooh, it's fun seeing everybody joining us. Angela, Crystal, nice to see you guys cooking. I know you guys usually cook. I am not. I'm going to sit here and enjoy. But I do like sheep hen recipes. And then, so you're putting them in peel and all. I'm also kind of a peel snob.
I was going to mention that, and that's a really good point. My grandmother always, she had, even during the day, because I'm old, she had a master's degree in home economics, and she always said so much of the nutrients come in the skin, and it doesn't bother me texture-wise, so I leave my skin on my carrots and my potatoes, and it saves me time, and I'm all about anything that saves me time, so that's kind of why it is that I do it. And hopefully Dawn is able to get her sound back. Katie, you may want to throw in the chat, and I'll say this for all of you guys as well. If you are using the Eventbrite link, it is having a tendency to have issues with sound. So always use the Zoom link next to it instead. So
yep. And you, if you ever log in and you run into that situation, let us know because we can send you the Zoom link once you get in.
Ooh, Stacy said that she roasted it on the sweet potatoes, no, russets on a separate with barley. Yeah, that sounds delicious. And you get, that would be a good one to be able to reheat and eat for lunches and things like that too. And Carolyn says she's using in broccoli, which would be delicious. A bitter green, I think, would go really well with this. I would like to throw kale in if I had any, in regular potatoes with the sweet potatoes. Yeah, use what you got. I am running to the end of like my produce for the week. Otherwise, I would be throwing some other things in as well.
Well, and I think that's what's really nice about roasting just about anything. You can pick just about any root vegetable. And with these type of, it could be almost a topping. So you definitely could use any sort of grain to go with it if you needed something else. Usually some of the like day old roasted stuff, I do like to throw on a salad sometimes the next day for lunch.
Oh yeah. Throw it on a bed like, of like arugula with oil and vinegar, something like that. Oh, I'm realizing I forgot to grab my balsamic vinegar, but I'll grab that in a minute. So I don't know about the rest of you guys, but I'm obsessed with those TikTok videos. So I bought containers for my produce, and you have to look very closely. So if you decide you've been watching those TikTok videos, most of their drawers they're not dishwasher safe. So I actually found some that were, and I don't know if you can kind of see that it has a little bottom panel. So it has airflow through it that stuff comes out. And I'm finding that my produce is lasting so much longer. And I've had other produce things as well. And I'm just loving that these are super easy, super stackable, and I can throw them in the dishwasher. So I'm trying to be that person that like when the produce comes in, it's all prepped and ready to go. Now it does say quarter all the Brussels sprouts, but if you have a Brussels sprout that is really big, and one that is really small, you know, quarter this one, cut this one in half. Try to keep your pieces close-ish to the same size. Snickers, do you want a Brussels sprout? He's not interested. He just went on a walk and he's tired. He's so lazy. I dreamed I got a dog for him last night and the dog's name was Buttercup. So I guess it's time for me to start looking for a friend for him. AKA me in the near future.
Looks like some other folks were having the different size Brussels sprouts as well. Missy found some really, really big ones. I like when I think Trader Joe's was really the only place that I've seen it, maybe Whole Foods, that'll sell them on the branch, which blew my mind the first time I saw them on a branch.
I know, it is a little freaky looking. Here, everybody wants to say hi.
Snickers.
He doesn't want Brussels sprouts. He's like, no. You sure? Oh, he doesn't. Sometimes he does. I know you're not supposed to give them a lot of sweet potato that it's fine cooked but raw, but he can have a little bite. No, he's not interested.
He's too tired.
Buddy, too long a walk. All right. He's my love. I saw that Trader Joe's, I'm like on all the Facebook pages for Trader Joe's, all the pumpkin stuff's out and talking about the branches. Apparently the little pumpkins on a stick are out and I cannot wait for it to cool off a little bit here so that I can get some. Cause if I buy it right now, it's just going to wilt in a day or two.
No, it was mild this morning here. You know, we only made it up to 90 today. So it was a balmy, you know, 78 this morning at like 10 o'clock.
I could have had a sweatshirt on this morning, but it's heated up as the day's gone on. But at least we're not in the big heat waves that we were having. Oh, Missy, I love Trader Joe's. It gets all my money. Flowers, candles, skin products. I love their skin products. And they have a new sunscreen that's a dupe for the Super Goop. And I like it even better than the Illa sunscreen that has like color in it. It just feels so good. So don't be afraid of trying out some of their skincare products. They're a good price and they work really well. I've even seen dermatologists do reviews saying that they are good quality as long as you're not using a scrub with actual abrasion on your face.
Well, I remember Trader Joe's started out very much as a coastal thing because it was there on the East Coast when I was in college. So my mom would always come with me, and we didn't get one in Tulsa where I grew up until much, much later, only probably about maybe 5 or so years ago. And that was like the first one. It was a big deal. And the parking lot is still crazy, crazy busy, crazy popular. All those.
The parking lot, I feel like they make them crazy. They're always the worst. I wish I had an Aldi in town, but we don't have that. We have Safeway. We have some independent, super expensive grocery stores. Mm-hmm. We have Whole Foods and Trader Joe's. That's what we got. No, even like Publix or, you know, Texans, no HEBs, which I totally miss from Texas.
Oh, Amber, I didn't know that. I was surprised. I feel like Trader Joe's would be all about the delivery and pickup. Interesting.
No, they don't. They absolutely, that was like a big thing that would show up on the Facebook groups a lot during the pandemic, especially getting close to the tail end of my Brussels sprouts here. Yeah, I wish it wasn't all these because I want that stupid advent calendar with cheese. Nobody else has that one.
That's fun. I always laugh with Brussels sprouts because my grandparents were big fans of Brussels sprouts. So I feel like in my millennial state, the like roasted Brussels sprouts was super popular. So when my grandma was like, "Do you want Brussels sprouts for dinner?" I was like, "Heck yeah." She brings out the like boiled Brussels sprouts. And I was like, "Oh, okay."
I never had Brussels sprouts till I was an adult. So see this little container, it just pops out. And so I can just throw it in the dishwasher all together. And like, I can put my asparagus or celery or carrots or whatever in here. I'm pretty pleased. I got like 3 of them for like $15 or something. And it does seem to have a good seal on it. So I'm happy about that. Now I'm going to actually grab a different cutting board because I am going to be using this to make a fall sangria. And I do not want meat on this cutting board.
Okay, so did you already preheat your oven?
I did preheat my oven. I'm using the convection bake, roast, not bake, and we'll see how that goes. I'm
gonna set this guy. Yep. So for those following along, she's obviously cubed the sweet potatoes. She's trimmed out the Brussels sprouts, and now we're getting ready to move to the sausage, which as she said, normally you are a vegetarian. Type. So I was even surprised that she was bringing out the big guns for this.
I just don't love the vegetarian. I don't know if it's the spices that they put in it. I like the Beyond Breakfast patty sausages, but for whatever reason, I don't like the sausage. And I find that a lot of times they fall apart on me as well. So I'm going to cut these on the bias right at the diagonal. But yeah, I can't tell you the last time I actually cooked meat, but one of those fancy grocery stores has amazing pre-made ham sandwiches, and I did have a ham sandwich yesterday. So like I said, I'm a flexitarian. It's just my body definitely prefers the vegetables over the meat. Mm-hmm. But you know, occasionally I'm okay with it.
Absolutely. And I tend to err on the turkey sausage side as opposed to chicken sausage. We do a lot of, I got the Southern upbringing. So when we do the big breakfasts with the like homemade biscuits, gravy, we still always do turkey sausage as the substitute. Cause we also had the like if anyone's from the Midwest or kind of the South, blue and gold sausage, which we tried that one time. And it was, I mean, it's all fat, which makes it amazing and very good in anything you put it in, but you're just drowning in fat.
Well, I mean, that's what makes, that's another reason is a lot of times I feel like the vegetarian ones taste a bit like sawdust, and it's because they don't have fat in it. And I feel like these Brussels sprouts need the fat to be delicious, because the best way is roasted Brussels sprouts with bacon, right? Like the, yes! That's the best way. But yeah, I never had Brussels sprouts until I was a full grown woman. I don't even think I had it in college. In my small town in Texas, it was not something you that was at the grocery store unless it was in the freezer section.
Right. Yeah, definitely making a comeback. And I err on more of, I prefer vegetables to fruit, just my personal preference. And my mother was the opposite. She was more of a fruit versus vegetables. So my sister and I, you know, ate more fruit. And then when we realized you could get, you know, asparagus doesn't actually have to be in a can.
Yeah, that's like, the only way I have asparagus in artichokes too.
Yeah.
Now Snickers is like, oh, there's something that smells really good. That's what I'm wanting. But I'm not giving you sausage, dude. You'll throw it up on the floor. I'll have to clean it up. I'm sorry. You only get veggies. That's it. That's it. That's all you get. I don't wash my hands.
Well, Candy, we're glad you're here.
Welcome, welcome. We just cut up everything.
We're still, yeah, finishing that up. So I was like, you can definitely catch up. We got plenty of time to catch up.
Yeah, I mean, this thing's going to bake for a really long time. I'm going to make some sangria, and we're going to have a conversation while it bakes. So there's no rush. This is such an easy, nice weeknight dinner. I'm going to grab my balsamic dressing.
When it comes to slicing them on a diagonal, is that just to get a little bit more surface area on the good part to get it kind of cooked and charred?
I think that is part of the reason. Also, some of it is a little bit of presentation as well. Though I'm not very good at cutting on the bias like that, I'm not going to lie. I finally used up all the good balsamic that I got for that arugula cooking series. My husband was using it on all his sandwiches. I'm like, you realize it's $50 balsamic, right? He's like, yeah, my sandwiches deserve that. The good sandwiches don't make themselves. This is the Trader Joe's cheapy one. So we'll see how it turns out.
Fancy sandwiches.
Fancy sandwiches. And don't get me wrong, he makes a good sandwich. Okay, so I'm going to mix these guys, the sauce, and then pour it on and toss it. And I meant to grab a bowl, so let me do that.
Okay, so we're, those of joining us, step five, we're getting ready to mix the glaze together.
Got my whisk, I got my toss. And I even have my tablespoon. So let's see, we need a tablespoon of Dijon. Excuse me.
You have any preference when it comes to Dijon mustards? I kind of like the one that still have a little bit of the seed in them, kind of the grainier ones.
I like that. The grocery store, the fancy grocery store that is close to my Pilates studio, seems to have a lot of this brand. And so that's just what I grabbed because it's what they had.
I do definitely like Dijon too. The kind of regular yellow mustard, surprisingly enough, but I'm not a big condiments person. I think it's always entertaining that I do love to cook, and stage managing these are really fun, but I'm actually an obnoxiously picky eater.
Really?
Yes. Always look for substitutions at any opportunity.
My maple syrup is super fancy. It was aged in a bourbon barrel from Whistle Pig. I found it at a spice shop and I had to buy it. And I will say, I cannot taste that much difference in the flavor, but it is what it is.
Well, if you like anything with the
sauce, you can always double this too.
Yeah, good point.
See how much sauce. I did measure my Brussels and everything to kind of like make sure that this was going to be enough sauce to toss with.
Absolutely.
The first time I've actually measured or weighed my produce before.
Well, I'm looking at the big sheet pan. That's usually good for two servings. I have a couple that I snagged for my parents that are like the quarter size. So they're perfect for like a single serving of things. So I know I've used those before when I don't want to have a ton of leftovers.
Oh yeah, for one person it does, like you don't want to eat the same thing all week. Exactly. So I got all of the ingredients for the sauce mixed in, some salt, some pepper, and I'm going to whisk it and then I'm going to toss it.
Avocado oil. Do you think you could substitute regular olive oil or
I would probably some of
the coconut oil?
I would not use coconut oil because it's going to leave a sweeter taste. But if you're into that, I like even the maple syrup makes me a little hesitant because I don't like sweet meat. I think I would use, and olive oil has a lower smoke point. So I'm not sure exactly if it would smoke in the oven or not. I think it would be fine. Mm-hmm. But I would probably use vegetable or canola.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm just tossing.
Ooh, that's a good tip, Stacey. Stacey measures her oil first so that helps with the other condiments coming out of the spoon. I would absolutely struggle.
Yeah, it's definitely really good, especially if you're using something like honey, right? That gets sticky and stuck in there. I'm trying to get all the last little bits out of this because I really don't feel like this is very saucy for all of this in the bowl, but we'll see.
Seeing others definitely like the leftovers. Megan uses a huge sheet pan because leftovers don't last long in hers, at her house. Jody is always using olive oil on the sheet pan meals. I feel like that's always a pretty solid staple.
Yeah, I feel like I use olive oil without any issue as well. And you know, I'm gonna add a little more black pepper because I'm not seeing like the actual pepper in here, so.
Ooh, and Crystal was already in the oven. So she's hanging out with us. We've got a fun recipe that Karen's going to throw together once we get it in the oven, just to get us in the mood.
For fall. I'm really waiting for the, for it to cool down. I'm like, it's September and we're having Indian summer. It's not my favorite.
Well, in Bailey, one of
them. It's not supposed to be 100 and something.
Bailey, one of our other facilitators, learned the term fool's ball. Apparently that's like a Tennessee thing where it's like suspiciously cool one day and then it ramps back up to like crazy heat wave. And I thought fool's ball was hilarious. It's my new favorite term.
I think I'm going to need a second sheet pan if I want these vegetables to roast and not steam. They need to have a little bit of space between them. So I'm going to actually grab a second cookie sheet. You can see I got a little space here, but I don't want it on top of each other because, right, we want that surface area to get nice and golden.
Yeah. So
that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to grab another one and some more foil.
Wow. So that does make a lot then. Because you said you measured everything else out.
Since we're doing two, I'm going to get a little curious. And as a past science teacher, I'm going to use the cookie sheet and put it on top to see with that more airflow on this one, if I actually like the way it turns out better, getting a little crispier on that. So we'll see which one we like better.
Oh yeah, Megan, if you've already bought that stuff, we always, I know some people come to just sit here and hang out with us and listen. We've got a couple that are tried and true cookers that go along with Karen, but a lot of people come just to be curious how that's being done. Getting all the fun tips and tricks still when they cook it later in the week. But sheet pan suppers for me are usually always great weekday staples because I work. And it's one of those that timing is everything. And so less activity required for me at the oven or stove or any of those things is always nice. Okay, first batch going in.
Second batch going right behind it.
Now we're gonna bake for 40 minutes, tossing once halfway.
People did say that it cooked faster than expected, and I am using the convection roast. So I should kind of take note of the time and in about 10 minutes, kind of take a peek at it, about 3:35-ish.
Okay.
Okay, so we're gonna make some sangria.
Yes, I'm excited about this one because we wanted to add something else. So I'm going to throw the recipe up there that she's going to throw together real quick. So if you just want to take a quick snapshot of it. But we thought a sangria would be a good mixed drink to kind of move into this, because also what's fun with sangrias is you can substitute just about anything. You can still use some of that fun fruit, all of those things.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, someone's just started cutting their sweet potatoes. They got the Aldi chicken apple sausage. Oh yeah, I wish I did not get ginger brandy since my back was hurting. I've just been icing it all day so I could be with you guys today. So I have regular brandy. I am using an alcoholic version, but you could definitely make this a mocktail without any issue. And it would be such a fancy way as the seasons change to celebrate with your kids or with someone who is sober curious or just plain old sober.
Absolutely.
I was going to say, and if my back hadn't been killing me today, I would have actually taken a little corn syrup onto a wine glass and gotten some of those cute little leaf sprinkles and make like a margarita rim with the little fall leaves to make it really pretty. So if you have any like, you know, baking supplies that are fall-like, you could really garnish this with it. Or even if you have like that glitter, that edible glitter, you could put a little in it and make it special and fancy. And I'm going to be mixing up into one of my other TikTok purchases. I've been doing infused waters in these and keeping it in the fridge. And I love it because it seals up on top and then it's got the nice little spout and it can sit in the fridge on the top shelf without taking up the whole bottom shelf.
Yeah, that's really cool.
Produce first.
I'm going to tell I feel like it was a slightly blonde story, but I was looking for non-alcoholic substitutes. And instead of taking me to some of the like non-alcoholic substitutes, I feel like my computer was telling me, well, guess what, dum-dum? They make non-alcoholic wines now. So they're like, the best substitute for Pinot Grigio is the non-alcoholic Pinot Grigio. So call me like, welcome to the 21st century here. But there are non-alcoholic versions of almost all the wines that I found pretty regularly available, but obviously bringing in kind of, I would say the traditional non-alcoholic substitutes, the grape juice, the sparkling wine, and even as we said, kind of the ginger ale, which would take the place of club soda and the ginger brandy.
A ginger beer, like a really spicy ginger beer, would be really good in this too. I just gave my husband the ingredients and said, hey, would you go get these? But if I was me shopping, I'd probably get one of the really strong ginger beers, because I really love that ginger flavor. And I like this too, because it is apple-y, but being a white wine, alcoholic or not, it is a little more transitional than like a traditional dark red wine. So it's a little refreshing and I feel like it blends the seasons together really nicely.
Absolutely. This is definitely a great transition because I'm also a like mulled cider fan. I'm a big fan of that in the fall, winter. And just, you know, the simple apple juice with, I like the dark Captain Morgan rum, that, and then there are these amazing, like just, simple kind of like pumpkin pie spice that's already mixed together, or kind of the cider. Then so that just throw those three things together, cook it down, and it's so easy.
It is so easy. I love mulled anything, mulled wine, mulled cider. It definitely just brings the holidays into the whole house. You know, it gives the smell and flavors of the season. And I'm not a big dessert person, so that to me is kind of my way of having those baked, I just threw a core in there. I'm pulling that back out if you're wondering what's going on there. A way of bringing in those flavors without actually cooking a cake or something along those lines.
Absolutely. And I feel like,
go ahead.
Well, I just feel like it's a great transitional, the sangria recipe. And then I feel like as soon as you start running the oven for more than, you know, 20 minutes, it's more of the fall preferred recipes. Fall is here. Use your oven.
I was also going to say you could totally infuse your own brandy too and just get some fresh ginger and slice it, put it into the bottle and shake it up over about a week's time, and then use some cheesecloth to strain it. You can do that with pretty much any kind of spices as such, as long as there's not like a high water content in those. So I've done that. I actually took a cocktails class that was super it was very unique. They took plum wine and they like boiled it down to almost a syrup. Then they infused gin with jasmine tea. And then it had sake and then sparkling. It just had like champagne in it as well. And it was absolutely so delicious. But I never thought about infusing with a tea before. And I thought that was a really interesting, fun idea. So I'm just slicing up the apple. I got a couple of pears in there. These are Honey Crisps.
Yum. And I just think apples are so, I love apples and sangria. I don't know if that falls into the like traditional or non-traditional, but I just think they taste really good.
It's traditional, but someone comments on it. I know citrus is one that goes a lot in the red wine sangria. It's been a long time since I've made a sangria. Looking to see what people are saying. Ooh, apple brandy for old fashions. I love a good old fashioned. That sounds really good.
Natasha said that her chicken apple sausage has some Gouda in it, so we'll see how that turns out. I mean, Gouda is going to have a good smoky.
If it's a smoked Gouda, yeah, it'll be really good. Of non-alcoholic or alcoholic beverages, at Target last week, I already drank them all, or I would show you. You know that I didn't realize it was a Whole Foods brand, but Waterloo with the sparkling, you know, like LaCroix.
Yeah,
that's their brand. They had a spiced apple one that was absolutely delicious, and it was delicious on its own, but it was also really delicious with a little bourbon poured into it. Super low calorie too, right? And super easy. Mm-hmm. Okay, I think that's going to be enough of my fruit in here. I can always add more, but I want to make sure I have enough room for the wine and everything in it. So got a bottle of Pinot Grigio. You know, it is sangria, so you're not going to use super high quality.
Yeah, it's just going to get better with time. Karen is making an alcoholic version, but we did provide some non-alcoholic substitutes.
Totally. And, you know, it'd be nice to do for maybe a brunch or something like that, a non-alcoholic version.
We did pull this off the internet. It got really good reviews, and it was definitely one of those, they doubled the batches for those type of gatherings, and they were quite popular.
Hey, see, now you know it really, like, this isn't a stage, this is my real home, right? Snickers.
Yeah, Natasha, definitely keep us posted on, she's got a maple honey blend, and then she's got the sausage that has the hint of cheese, the Gouda cheese.
I have to show my dog the water gun to make him stop barking. I have to spray him if he doesn't stop. And see, I just showed it to him, and now he's quiet.
Love it.
Brat.
I know, he was not all about the cooking social today. Didn't want any of the scraps.
He was in a mood. I think it's the heat. He's not been happy about the heat. He doesn't want to go on walks in the heat. He refuses to do much of anything. You know, he's a pampered pooch. And since I lost Petey, he's definitely even more pampered.
Got about a minute left before we hit that 10-minute mark that you were going
to
go back.
Awesome. I can smell it already. It's starting to smell really good. Okay, so I know... I pulled the recipe up on my iPad. I literally have every electronic here so that I can get this going. Okay, 2.5 cups apple cider. I'm using the non-alcoholic, but you could probably use alcoholic too if you wanted to, a little more fizz.
Candies is in the oven as well.
All right.
Once you get done pouring, I know you had you had quite the knowledge on balsamic vinegar. Looks like we've got other folks that are learning about the different balsamics.
Yeah, let me do a quick check and see how we're doing.
Yep.
Ooh, let me take you guys with me. The problem is my camera's frozen here, so you're gonna have to kind of let me know if you can see. Can you see the? Can you see the oven?
We can see your lovely face.
Oh shoot, you're getting a close up, right? Okay, let's try this way. Yes,
definitely.
Okay, so it's getting, everything's getting kind of brown. So I'm going to go ahead and give it a toss now.
Toss. I'm doing a lazy man's version instead of pulling it out. I'm just kind of tossing it right in the pan.
Oh, that's good. And it's still got quite a bit of the glaze on it.
Yeah, it you can see it, the sausage is starting to color and the Brussels are starting to darken and shades as well. So balsamic vinegar. Ultimately, if it's like that Trader Joe's, unless it has the seal from Italy, it's not actually real balsamic. Most like the cheaper balsamics are using caramel flavoring. It's not aged in a barrel. So like the real ones need to have a mark on it. So let's see if I can move the chat out of the way so you can see the emblem. Right here. This is the seal saying that it is the good, authentic stuff. Woo! And this is made in Mondena, Italy. So this is like the expensive one.
Got
and
the fancy kind.
Trader Joe's does not have that mark saying that it came from that region. So it is not an authentic. And this says it is great must organic wine vinegar. So it's cut with organic wine vinegar. But this one is just the musk, I think. So they've added stuff to this. Does this still taste really good when I use them every day? Yeah, I still use this, but this is like the good stuff.
Nice. Missy is going to be adding some cherry tomatoes at the end of hers, would also be really good. A little bit more acid in there. Help maybe with the vinegar, and Angela's is also now in the oven.
Nice. Okay, I gotta look my recipe up again so I know how much brandy. Yeah. So I'm gonna do 1 cup club soda, 1/2 cup brandy.
Linda, thank you for the compliment. I did realize that I'm obnoxiously tie-dyed for the day. I've got like this tie-dyed shirt, I've got a long sleeve one, and my cup is on the tie-dyed side. So yeah. Just hanging out in all the bright colors because I couldn't decide which one to wear.
Tie dye is like super popular right now.
Well, and I think what's sad is a couple of the other events that I've hosted over the course of a couple months, some, I think for a while, the last like 3 or 4 that were recorded, I'm in the same shirt. Apparently all I wear is tie dye. Ooh, someone else is going to add some mushrooms. Mushrooms would be good in this as well if you're a mushroom fan.
Totally would be good. You know, you could probably do it with mushrooms and not even have the sausage and have it be delicious.
Ooh, yeah, portobello is a good substitute, meat substitute.
I wish I'd thought of that earlier. I could have done that. All right. Good. So my sangria is just chilling.
Ooh. Walnut, Angela, great idea. That's going to give it a good nutty roasted flavor.
Ooh, walnuts, just make sure that you add them at the end so they don't burn on you. Because you know that nuts can be a little finicky. All right, give this a little shimmy shake. And then
Region of Italy for the balsamic vinegar? Got a couple questions about that.
It is Modena, M-O-D-E-N-A.
M-O, yeah, there we go. Someone else spelled it first, nice.
All right, went to, for my anniversary for my husband, I found that San Francisco has a ton of tiki bars. And so this is one of the cups we got from one of the tiki bars. We're trying to hit all of them before our next anniversary.
Oh, that's fun.
Yeah, this one, they call it Last Rites, and they actually had a cinnamon stick that was smoldering on top, which was kind of a fun touch. Okay, so let's see how this is. Of course, this is going to be better after sitting in the fridge, but, you know, let's see. Yeah, this is really yummy. It's not, it almost tastes like apple juice. I taste the apple in it a lot more than the actual wine. I do catch a hint of the effervescence. I think I would prefer it with ginger beer versus the club soda if I was going to do it again. I'm going to stick this in the fridge.
Yeah, Ben, we do need to applaud Karen because we came up with this idea yesterday. So she went with what she got. So I was super impressed. So definitely applauding that just because we wanted something else to go with it. And last time I was at a social event, we made the tacos and she made a bunch of other extras to include a margarita.
It was a good margarita too, but what the best one of that social was actually the Instapot Mexican rice. Yeah. It was so good. It was so easy because I think it was just white rice, cheap white rice, a beef bouillon cube. It was supposed to be a tomato bouillon cube, but Amazon sent me the wrong kind. And then frozen peas and carrots. And I just put it in there. And my husband's like, this is so good.
I think it was really good. You had beans and something. I don't know if it was on.
I did some black beans too. Yeah. Sauteed off some onions and garlic. You can really make black beans taste pretty good if you are doing that. Cinnamon sugar would be good, Tina. That would be really nice. And then garnish it beautifully on the side.
Well, what made me think is when you were talking about the edible sugar and how those are becoming the new thing, you could dust an apple and garnish it with an apple, or even like a caramely apple, I think would taste good with those things. As just
for sure. Would totally be delicious.
Like an apple.
Do you have the time kind of going still for another time, or am I just kind of keeping my eye going?
Well, 5:25 is when you put it in my time, so 3:25, and we're coming up on 20 minutes.
Okay, I think I'm going to leave it about 5 more minutes and then give it another check. I'm going to turn you guys around, and I'm going to take you into a place that I can sit since my back hurts.
Well, and the rice brought up a good point as we were discussing kind of the theme of this month still being balance, and that we were talking kind of back and forth of like where you find some of the balance with cooking and wanting to cook at home and wanting to eat at home. I am a huge fan of any sort of like shortcut or, hack type deal. So we were talking about the rice. I've got a ton of microwave rice in various forms that I can stick in the microwave, and they're all pretty good, pretty tasty, just as any sort of side or just like any sort of bowl. But you, Karen, you said you had some pretty good Instapot recipes for that.
Yeah, I love using the Instapot for sure. It saves so much time. And this week, with the heat wave, it was really helpful for not heating up the whole house by using the Instapot. And I actually, it was the first time that I was using the slow cooker for it. So I did some slow cooker meals. And one was a tortilla soup, a vegan tortilla soup. Turned out really good. I did a lentil curry. And I swear there was one other thing that I did in it that turned out really, it was a corn pepper soup that I garnished with like avocado and tortilla chips and lime. And it turned out really nice. I used to actually be a test cook. There's a site, it's called Once a Month, Cooking Once a Month, Once a Month Meal, something along those lines. I have to think about it for a second because they changed it. It was like Once a Month Mom, and then they took the mom out of it. But they actually, you can go onto their site and you can do piecemeal of the recipes. But if you subscribe, of course, you can get the grocery list, but you can choose what apparatus that you want. And you can like dump and go meals that you can have the stuff in the freezer and throw it into the waffle iron or into the Instapot or anything like that. And so that's really helpful when it comes to things like that. Once a Month Moms is what it was called. Once a Month Meals is what it's called now. Yeah. And if you like are looking for something to be able to be a fast, easy, the database is very easy to search and go through like that as well. I mean, I do love the food boxes, but sometimes even that seems like a little much on a good day, you know? Absolutely. I don't know. What about you guys? What is yours? What are y'all's to do fast meals that you're able to throw together or things that you do that makes it so much easier?
Anyone on the meal prep side or maybe not meal prep side? I'm one of those that I do one of the home delivery stuff. Home Chef's the one that I use right now. huge fan, but at the same time, I'm one of those that if you make me get out more than one pot or one pan, I'm a little annoyed because that means I have to clean it. And I try to minimize, I mean, they're all dishwasher safe because let's be honest, I don't buy anything that can't be dishwasher or microwave safe to this day and age.
I feel you on that 100%. And it's like people drinking out of crystal and I'm like, no, thanks. I don't have a maid to wash it. I'm going to be washing it. I don't want to do that.
Well, and my mother's a wonderful person. When she comes to visit, that's when I bring out the stuff that can only be hand washed. So I have like a little pile when she comes in by the sink. She's like, so are these going to be things you want me to wash? And I'm like, please.
maybe a little bit. Yeah, that's nice. Jody was saying that the Factor meals are good. I have not tried Factor. I keep seeing them on like my Insta feed. I have not tried it. I do use Thistle now and then. It is expensive, but I try to do like one smoothie, a couple of snacks, and then like a salad that's a dinner salad that I'll split into two meals. And that way I can keep my lunches at about $40 a week, which is still not cheap. But, you know, depending on if it's a really crazy week, that's about the same as you would pay for fast food or picking something up at the grocery store, like a pre-made sandwich or whatever.
Absolutely.
Crystal says she makes those breakfast burritos. I know a lot of people like to do those and like freeze them. Mm-hmm. And one of the tricks I see a lot, which I haven't tried because I'm not a big egg fan, is doing a full cookie sheet and then just cutting it up instead of frying all the eggs individually and then sticking on those breakfast ones.
I've done them in muffin tins, kind of the muffin tin with egg, one egg in each kind of muffin tin. I've done those before. They're pretty good, but I'm kind of like you. The egg texture gets a little funky a couple days after. And yeah, I'm such a picky eater that just got to get excited about it.
Crystal, I saw that you were asking about the corn soup. If you just Google crockpot vegan meals, it's the first link that will pop up and has like 30 of them. And that's actually where I did all of the meals for the week.
I'm impressed with Tina's. Tina take it to like a science level. She has a 30 meal board, created a graph with columns, chicken, pork, seafood, beef, created little tiles with magnets with the name of the recipe on it. That's genius when it comes to menu planning. I feel like I've got a couple like recipes, books that just take a while. But that's awesome.
Okay. I mean, that is super organized. I'm not that organized at all. I
aspire to be that organized.
I have a friend who her sister's about to start chemo and she's like, hey, you know, do you recommend any freezer meals? Like, if you have fresh vegetables and you freeze them, you know, how do they reheat? And I'm all like, well, it's kind of like, it needs to be a texture of like a stew, not a stir fry, right? So if you're wanting a crunchy, it's really hard to get that crunch if it's been frozen. That's why I don't use a lot of frozen vegetables unless it's something that's going to be soft. I do like doing a lot of grain bowls. Those are super nice. Make up one thing of farro or quinoa or whatever, roast some vegetables, make some sort of sauce. But when you said the eggs, it made me think there was a Domino magazine had it years ago when I first got married and you baked the egg into a cookie, not a muffin pan. And you had it and then had a little slice of ham. I didn't eat because I was in Texas. I didn't eat vegetable based for the most part then. And then you put your English muffins, but what was the fake holidays was mayonnaise, mustard, cayenne pepper, and lemon juice. And you would put it over like a fake holidays sauce. Ooh, and it was actually really good. And it was like a super fast way and that can keep in the fridge for, you know, a week and you could just reheat that and eat it that way.
Tina was going to show her magnetized meal system.
Oh my gosh. Look at her. That is like another level organized, guys. That's so awesome.
I just think having the protein listed is genius because then I definitely gravitate to, you could definitely do a pan supper for just about every protein.
You could.
A combination of roasted vegetables. And that's even the seafood does well there. No, but that's genius.
I'm taking you guys with me to the oven.
Thank you for sharing, Tina. I love it.
Yeah, that is next level.
I was gonna say I've used like fun stickers, and so I have the like magnetized stuff that I did. So I have the like sheets of magnets. So I need to do something more fun like that. But I've used them as I've made my own sticker or magnet sticker things.
I think we're there.
Really? So that was only about 25 minutes? Yeah, 25 minutes. Well, I can only imagine compiling all the recipes. My dad brought over his mother's recipe cards. She passed away a couple years ago. So I've got like boxes, like the old school boxes where you wrote out the recipes by hand in the cards. And I'm going through to like organize and disperse it because my mom and sister are both interested, but don't have the patience to go through it. But I've got like four boxes, two of those kind of big books. But she was definitely one of those that liked to cut out the like, what I would say kind of the fast meals, but you know, that they were back on the like Philadelphia cheese. She had a couple of those, couple of the magazines. That was good, Karen.
The Brussels are just, I mean, I can see why they said, watch it. The Brussels are nice and round, but if you can kind of take a look here, I feel honestly that the cookie sheets got browner from the contact with the dressing versus the one that was
on the grate. They do look a little like kind of crispier.
These look like they dehydrated more, but yeah. The one on the cookie sheet caramelized more. It did not make sense.
Yeah. Oh, and Natasha said if you used an air fryer, hers only took 12 minutes to cook. So that made it even more fast.
Oh, that's a great hack right there.
Yeah.
I'm not allowed to get an air fryer, and my Instapot's the small one, so I can't put the air fryer because it's a unitasker. But I do have air fry in my oven, but it's not as fast. Okay, well, so I'm going to play a little of this.
Karen, do you have a preference? Do you like yours with your vegetables, so with a little bit of bite, or?
Yes, I do.
I was going to say, I'm the same way. So I would say definitely this is when you start. Like I said, it was about 25 minutes when she pulled her stuff out. So obviously oven dependent, but I would also say if you like them a little, I hate to use the word mushy because that doesn't make it sound appetizing. If you like them with less bite, less bite. A little bit longer.
So I'm going to take a couple from each side to see if I can actually tell a difference between them or not.
That's fair, Natasha.
And if you're like, that's not a very big portion, it's because when I don't feel good, I want mashed potatoes, and I ate an entire 4-serving thing of mashed potatoes right before the social. Let me just say, Martha Stewart in the freezer section, cream cheese mashed potatoes, she knows what she's doing. They're delicious.
I think cream cheese is a definitely really good hack to replace some of the like cream, like heavy cream, whipped cream, any of those things. I find that quite genius. On the cream cheese side, I wouldn't say I'm the biggest, again, picky eater, not the biggest cream cheese fan. I don't need it on a bagel, but adding it to sauces definitely gives that cream cheese the like cream without, because then you can still use kind of the low fat, those type of things. It was pretty genius and it melts really quite well. I was surprised. I am now
a convert. That's like if I get, they don't have them right now, but they used to, the Trader Joe's frozen ones, I would always add butter and cream cheese to it. Okay, so this is the one that came off the cookie sheet. This is the one that was on like the baking tray. Not really any caramelization on a sweet potato. Brussels sprout still has a little bite to it.
Which that's my preference, because then it gets a little too boiled Brussels sprouty.
But you can even see it's got way more color on it, on the sweet potato that was on the cookie sheet from being in contact with the sauce the entire time. So I'm going to say foil for the win.
Well, and it's the, you know, you can now not have to do the big deep clean for the pan.
Finding the balance.
Oh, yeah, Natasha, I bet your kid's gonna love it. Any way to hide like really good vegetables, I think, is great.
You're doing something right if your kid is gonna eat this with the Brussels sprouts and such. That's great.
Yeah.
People were saying in the Founders Club that their kids loved it.
This is definitely, like I said, it's certainly a popular one. Yes, I agree with the compatibility. It's
Natasha, how do you like to eat? Are you don't eat a lot of processed or a lot of carbs, processed carbs? Or just out of curiosity, I'm always interested in people's eating habits and what works for their body versus the other. And even with the sausage, you can see, like, this is the one that was like on the cookie sheet without the foil. And then this is the one that had the foil on it. The sausage even has way more color on it. And here I go eating meat on camera. It feels weird. But it's good. It's good.
Hot. I can relate to the anti-inflammatory, Tina. I have to watch what I eat in that regard.
Anti-inflammatory, cool.
Yep, agree. Roasted vegetables are great for the winter. Yeah, new sauces, absolutely. Is it super sweet? Because I just think
no. If
you put maple syrup on anything, I just no. Flashbacks to
pain. I was a little worried about the maple syrup, but I think, and a lot of times they'll do this with Timbits too, when you're frying it in the pan. You want that little sugar just to give the caramelization. So sometimes they'll literally have me put a packet of sugar on it towards the end and it will get that color on it. So yeah,
I think you could do honey instead of maple syrup.
Yeah, you totally could.
Just
you could use agave paste or not agave, agave.
You know, you still have the honey mustard. Yeah. If you need that, just like ever so slight sweet on the sweet potatoes.
I think the honey mustard would be nice because it would be a stronger mustard flavor.
Mm-hmm.
Because the Dijon isn't as like sharp as like a yellow mustard.
Yeah. No, fair.
Yeah, I think this was really good. Do you want to talk a little bit about balance before we head off camera? Does anybody want to talk about how they're embracing balance so far this month? Any successes that they've had? They could share in the chat. You could come off and actually talk to us. It's the only social you can actually do that.
Yeah. Whoa, Missy had a side with spinach, almonds, blueberries, balsamic, and dressing.
Mm.
That's a good side with this to cut kind of the roasted flavor.
But yeah.
I also love a good spinach salad.
I think the greens is the bitter greens, like a spinach, a kale, arugula, something kind of peppery would be a nice complement to this versus just like a romaine salad. Like, I don't think Caesar salad would do much for this.
No, agreed.
I mean, Caesar salad is delicious, don't get me wrong. And an iceberg would do nothing for this. I think it needs more complexity of flavors. But yeah, that's what we got for you guys. Hopefully you guys are enjoying this month of balance. I know Malika is doing the weekly setup tomorrow. I'm stage managing, and then I will be hosting the Monday morning one bright and early. Katie, when are you back on camera?
I am doing one of the annuals this week, annual supplements. I think this will be my like second one in the row, but it's the annual, the visualization. So that's in our new, it's the annual supplement. That's now the self-care workbook. And I'll be doing that Thursday. It's page 43, page 46. And then I think I come in as a stage manager for something a little bit later in the month, but I did a Notice Nature earlier. Notice Nature in the balance log, which I had fun with that. And when we share the link at the end, definitely, I always laugh at the Notice Nature pages because this is my third Notice Nature. And I think Karen, you've done one as well.
I have.
I think I laugh when I see it, but now I've definitely become a believer of it's the get out, turn off your brain, notice everything around you, tap into the senses, turn everything off. And I think that's really the kind of elegant approach to it.
People are going talking a little bit about balance and that it is definitely something we all need and need more of. And I 100% agree with that as well. And I will say that the one thing I helped me replenish and still helping me balance this month is to really set aside the time for myself and like scheduling it like a doctor's appointment and using it as a non-negotiable. If it's time for meal prep, something good and healthy for me to eat, if it's time for me to exercise, or if it's even just time for me to curl up with a book or to binge watch whatever I want to watch on Netflix. I think scheduling that would definitely be super beneficial, marking it on the calendar and using it as a non-negotiable. Actually, says the theme has helped her with planning the event next month, is helping me let others help me with major elements. Oh, that's a huge one right there. Wow, that's great. Candy said she missed replenish because it was a crazy month and she's been going back for more than balance. Great job environment, empty nester. So balance has not it just hasn't worked for you. You know what? Some things are going to resonate with you better than others, and that's okay.
Absolutely. And that's why I like that it's a new adventure each month, because there are ones that it's already kind of in my routine, and there are others that it's like, I have to find a completely different definition or a synonym of the word because I just can't embrace the initial thought. Adoration was the one that really threw me for a loop. I had to go to admiration because I just couldn't wrap my head around anything on the adoration side.
I think my favorite one in the last year has been spontaneity. And that one, it took me a bit to definitely get into, but I really enjoyed it. And replenish, I struggled with throughout most of the month. And then if you guys were with me on the July annual supplement, when I put together my ritual bins, that has been a game changer for me, having everything in one place that I need for my mornings and my evenings as well. And I've tweaked my evenings some. If you were at my weekly, or maybe I shared it the monthly, I got one of those, what do you call it? It's like little pocket that you shove underneath your bed. And so you can put all your stuff along in the side. So I have like a little journal and a pen, and then I have my headband, earphones, and I have my skincare, and I have all of that set up. So it's all in one place. And that definitely, and after being consistent with it, it did make a big difference. And I felt more replenished, which in hand lended itself to make me feel more balanced within my work.
Absolutely. And I know you had worked pretty hard on your rituals, getting those in. And I've noticed that that's almost a calming effect to you. The couple times I've checked in with you on these type of things, there's a calm to you.
There's a calm.
Maybe it's also you're feeling better. I know you were sick for quite a while.
Yeah, I am. If I hadn't thrown my back out, I'd be way better. But you know, that's what I get. It's this crazy move. So I'm at Pilates. I already have Reformer and Mat, but they're all separate certifications. And so there's a Cadillac and it looks like a 4-poster bed or a kinky sex toy. I don't know which. Sorry if that offended you, but that's what it looks like. And they have springs with handles, and you were supposed to be side lunging and punching like a fencer. And with the twerk of it, I didn't hold my core in it. And I decided I'd already signed up for a class. And so I took a class after that, and we were doing planking where feet move from one side to the other. So you're dipping your hips from one side to the other side, one side to the other side. And my back cracked so loud, the whole class stopped and hurt it. So I have a feeling the two of those things together are what my issue is today.
Definitely.
Yeah.
There was a question that came up. Do we know if you can cut up extra sweet potato and put it in the freezer or the fridge? I'm not a sweet potato person. So if you've already cut them up.
I think you can freeze sweet potato, and I think it would be okay for 3 or 4 days in the fridge uncooked. We're meaning uncooked?
Yes, uncooked.
Yeah, I think it'll be fine for a few days.
It'll start to
put in an airtight container.
It'll start to brown in the fridge.
It'll start to oxidize.
Yep.
Cool. Yeah, put it in like one of the containers that is sealed. Or like super airtight sealed.
One of the acids on it. Thanks for that, Crystal. That was helpful. I know. Natasha's kiddo gave it a big thumbs up. So it's kid approved. I love seeing the kids' involvement. I know they're participating in some of the coloring events. Looked like someone was going to do the Notice Nature page with their son. So I think that's always really fun. But definitely seeing a lot of effort into taking time for self-care, which I think is what balance has really triggered, balance and replenish.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. Well, I think we're going to wrap it up at this point, unless anybody has something they just want to be able to share, a celebration, anything like that.
We've seen just some of the fun stuff.
And, you know, take pictures of your wonderful meal and post it on Sonder Club.
Absolutely. And would love to hear any of the other alterations that you have done or changes. Like I said, this is one of those really versatile ones that you can definitely make it look like something completely different.
Yeah, I mean, think about it. With this, shrimp would be delicious added with
just,
right?
I
sausage and shrimp is the key. Is I grew up on near Louisiana, so that's what it makes me think of.
Shrimp, roasted potatoes, cherry tomatoes, and mushrooms.
Yum. Well, I thank you all so much for being here, and we're thrilled. It's one of our favorite socials because it's the least formal, and that's fun. So thank you for being here, and we'll have that survey that goes out to you and YouTube QR codes all up there. And I love that the kids are eating this and that you guys are doing it. And it's 455 calories. Crystal, you were on top of it. I love it. All right. We're going to lead you guys out with a little music of Earth, Wind, and Fire, appropriate for the month.
Yeah. And I'll throw in the other links in the chat as we go out. But it was nice to see everybody.
Thanks for being here. And I guess I'll probably see some of you guys in the next 2 days, in the next two socials.